Well, greetings and welcome to Grace as we get underway for another study today. We're going to construct a building. We've been in the process of laying the foundation, or at least clearing the ground, we could say, for this building. This is a different type of building. This is a building not a building in the sense of a physical structure. This is a building or an edifice that Paul talked about when he referred to the building up of the believer. This is a doctrinal edifice. If you have placed your trust in the finished and the all-sufficiency of the crosswork of Jesus Christ, then you too can rightly consider yourself to be in a building process as we speak. And this is the building process that Paul had in mind. This is a building of knowledge. That's what it's all about. Knowledge, or we might say a building of godly wisdom that's built within the soul of the believer. And it begins to take shape as every believer begins to take in sound doctrine, divine wisdom, according to the building plans that were set forth to us by the apostle in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. We used that passage in 2 Timothy, I believe several weeks ago now, along with one in Ephesians to sort of get us underway here as a, we could say, a jumping off place to get us started. So let's review these two passages as we begin to dig into the study today. First, the passage in Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 4, beginning with verse 11, Paul writes, "And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers." It was God's plan. God ordained that certain positions be in effect or in place for the building up of the body of Christ. Those positions down through time are as they're stated there. Notice the purpose here, for the perfecting of the saints. In other words, for the maturing, the growing up of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying, literally the building up again of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Paul's beginning that building process for us here in Romans. Now, couple the underlined portions of that passage in Ephesians, you see it on the overhead there, couple that with this passage in 2 Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17, where Paul writes, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness." This is what this building is all about. "That the man of God may be perfect," the idea being spiritually mature, doctrinally mature, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Here in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, we find that the material used in this building process of every believer is Scripture itself. Scripture applied according to the order. Paul spells out doctrine first, reproof, correction. And in Ephesians, we have that list Paul's given us of those who God's given to the church, the positions for the purpose of conveying this doctrine according to that divine design for the edification of believers today. As we said earlier, Romans is the foundational book. Fundamental truth, because Romans contains fundamental doctrines concerning faith doctrine. So this is the beginning point in our edification building program. We begin with the foundation of faith, that's Romans, and we must lay a firm foundation. I would say a firm enough foundation so that we can add the superstructure doctrines that come later on in this building process. At the entrance of Romans, we went through, some weeks ago now, the introduction to the foundation in verses 1 through 15. We've covered that much. And by the way, just a brief review, you recall how the very first thing Paul did was he established the fact of his unique and distinct Gentile apostleship. Now, this is very important. In fact, it's crucial we understand this at the outset of our study. You see, we have not yet begun to pour the actual foundation. We're looking at the architect, the chief architect for the faith today, the plan that God has, his purpose for the body of Christ today. Remember, we said the first 15 verses of Romans could be viewed as the ground leveling project. This is where Paul begins his introduction before he gets into the great doctrinal truths we're going to discover in this Romans epistle. But keep in mind, this introduction or this ground leveling is every bit as important as actually pouring the foundation. What happens if we shortchange the leveling process? if we shortchange the leveling the field where the superstructure, this structure is going to be built, we end up with that house built on sand we've heard about, and some of us have sung about in our younger Sunday school days. So let's do a quick ground check. Just to be absolutely sure we have the truths Paul establishes in these first few verses absolutely established in our minds before we allow the pouring to begin. Paul begins with three doctrinal issues in Romans 1:1. Regarding his ministry. And they're found in that first verse of Romans 1:1, a servant. Notice how servant comes first. This is going to play a large part when we come into this issue of agape later on down the road. A servant of Jesus Christ, called and to be, and the word and, to be and, are in italics, should be in italics here, called apostle, not called to become an apostle. That some hierarchy's got to place him in, but called apostle. Paul was a sent one, sent from the ascended Jesus Christ to the Gentiles for the age of grace. Separated, notice he says, separated unto the gospel of God. So there in verse 1, Paul tells us that he was a separated apostle. In other words, we need to have firmly established in our minds the fact that Paul worked under a different program than the apostles that of Christ that had come before him. That word separated means to be taken away from or set apart from something else. So we need to understand how Paul was separated and what made Paul unique before we go further. Let's spend just a few minutes reviewing this. First of all, Paul was separated from the other servants or the other apostles of Jesus Christ, and in a particular manner. In other words, Paul was not one of the 12 apostles, which tells us that Paul was not an earthly kingdom program apostle. You see, God had no need for an additional apostle to fulfill the program of Israel's promised earthly kingdom. How many tribes are there in Israel? 12. Everything related to Israel's program comes with the number 12. God did not add a 13th to that program. In spite of what someone emailed me yesterday that he'd heard on the radio program that day, that in the mind of this pastor teacher, Paul should have been the 12th instead of Matthias to replace Judas. So person doesn't understand rightly dividing the word of truth. True Israel, comprised of those among the 12 tribes who had accepted Christ as their king, their Messiah, had been promised to become a holy nation. They had been promised by God to be a kingdom of priests. God had likewise promised the 12 apostles that they would each reign on one of the 12 thrones that would be set up over the 12 tribes of Israel when that earthly kingdom was established here on planet Earth. If you're counting, that's an apostle to a tribe, is it not? Well, that kingdom was offered to the nation Israel. It was proclaimed to be at hand, which was good news. That is a set of good news in your Bible. That's why it's called the good news or the gospel of the kingdom. It was proclaimed to be at hand by John the Baptist and by the kingdom apostles and by Christ himself during his earthly ministry. In fact, the good news that this earthly kingdom was right at Israel's doorstep, right within her grasp, we could say, was called the gospel, meaning the good news of the impending promised earthly kingdom. That's why we call the program of which the 12 were associated the kingdom program. So you know what we're talking about there. It has to do with that earthly kingdom to be set up here on planet Earth. Israel's promised kingdom was right at their doorstep, right within their grasp. They had only to accept Christ as their Messiah, believing that he was indeed the very Son of God. Notice with me a couple of verses that speak of the good news of Israel's promised kingdom. Matthew 9:35, Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, and preaching what gospel? The gospel of the kingdom, the good news of the kingdom being right there, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. God was not an ear specialist, or a growing one leg specialist, or any of the other types of specialists we see through TV telemarketers today. If you recall, this healing spoken of here was precisely what had been promised the nation Israel concerning that promised earthly kingdom. The prophet Isaiah said in Isaiah chapter 33, verse 24, the inhabitant of that kingdom, when it's set up here on planet Earth, time future, shall not say, I am sick. Why not? Because there will be no sickness affiliated with that kingdom when Christ is ruling and reigning on the throne. And through that physical healing characteristic of that kingdom, God the Father will be glorified, according to the pages of Scripture. John stated as much in John 14:13, where John said, "Whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son." So all this healing that took place in Israel's program and in connection with the impending earthly kingdom was the Father's way of being glorified in the righteous rule and reign of Christ right here on planet Earth. When the Son is present and reigning upon this earth, sickness will be a thing of the past. A glorious thing for those folks. So the good news for these people, or those people, during the time of Christ's earthly ministry was the fact that the promised earthly kingdom and the things associated with that kingdom, such as we see right here, were right at their doorstep. Certainly good news. Wouldn't it be good news to you if someone came along and said, the catching up of the body of Christ into the air is right at hand? And it was a prophet from God. How many of us would be excited about that? How many of us would be thinking a little differently in the course of our everyday lives? How much outward expression rather than inward focus do you think would be taking place if someone were walking the back door and say, it's right at hand. God's told me to tell you folks, you're catching up to be with him is right at your doorstep. My goodness, would we begin to have, in my opinion, an outer focus. I think the love and the affection and the preferring others above self would be heightened to such a degree that things would totally change for the body of Christ and those to whom the body of Christ relates, if that were the case. But we're told that's the case through the Apostle Paul. That's the doctrine of imminence. We never know when it'll take place. Could take place today, tomorrow, we don't know, but it's going to take place according to our apostle. When the Son is present, reigning upon this planet, sickness will be a thing of the past for those folks. So the good news, during that time, during the time of Christ's earthly ministry as a Jew under law to Jews under law, was the fact that the promised earthly kingdom, right there at their doorstep. Notice Mark chapter 1, verses 14 and 15. Now after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee, earthly ministry to Israel, preaching the gospel, meaning the good news of the kingdom of God. This is speaking of an earthly kingdom here. That's why we call it the kingdom program. What would make this good news? Well, verse 15 goes on to tell us there, and saying the time was fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye, metanoia. In other words, change your thinking. Change your minds, Israel, and believe the good news and believe who your Messiah truly is. Israel was right in the threshold of that promised earthly kingdom. The only condition for that promise, that earthly kingdom coming to fruition, was that the Israelites changed their minds about the identity of their Messiah. And also the fact that they had failed under that performance contract called the law to gain a righteous standing in the eyes of Almighty God. You see, the problem with most of the Israelites was the fact that they just could not bring themselves to believe that Christ was the king. They didn't think that Christ had ever been very much of a king. They couldn't picture him in that manner. And in their human reasoning, if he was unable to come down off of that cross, when they were saying, come down off that cross if you're truly the king, why should they be willing to believe him powerful enough to deliver them from all their enemies and to bring in that earthly kingdom and the everlasting peace promised by the prophets? You see the dilemma these folks were in. Why, they wanted a warrior king. They didn't want a meek and mild mannered king. They wanted a triumphant, conquering hero type king. And they had a huge problem in viewing Christ in that regard. So Israel as a nation rejected their king. They rejected their promised Messiah and thus rejected their kingdom. They rejected the ministry of John the Baptist. They rejected the ministry of the 12 apostles proclaiming that kingdom be at hand. Then they rejected the ministry of the king himself as he was right there present with them and proclaiming the same message. But the last straw, we could say, the last proverbial straw added to the back of their unbelief was when they rejected the ministry of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. Israel did indeed do that, along with the accompanying visual manifestations at Pentecost that had been promised in connection with that earthly kingdom. They were given all the visible proof they could possibly need to see that that kingdom was right at their doorstep. When they rejected the Holy Spirit, his ministry at Pentecost, folks, they committed what you commonly hear referred to today as the unpardonable sin. But you can see that it has to do with that nation. has to do with those folks who actually experienced the sign manifestations of their kingdom being at hand. God called that blaspheming the Holy Spirit. Israel, the nation Israel, who witnessed the Holy Spirit's ministry and the manifestation, the visible manifestations of that kingdom, were the only people that could commit the unpardonable sin. I know there's much confusion about that issue today, and but you need to understand the unpardonable sin's not something you can commit. We're unique to Israel because Israel tasted of the power, the enablements, we could say, of the coming earthly kingdom through those physical ailments, enablements provided at Pentecost. They tasted the power, we might say, of the promised earthly kingdom. They partook of the benefits of that power, many of them provided by the Holy Spirit, according to the writer of Hebrews. Is any sin unpardonable today? Thank you. Absolutely not. Now, someone has said to me, well, to fail to accept Christ as Savior is to commit the unpardonable sin during the age of grace, but a lot of things we could say about that. Is it possible for you to sin after you die? And even before, let's say you you change your mind. Let's say yesterday you didn't believe that Christ was the one who came, and through his death at Calvary, the sin issue resolved. Let's say you didn't believe that yesterday, but you believe it today. Was that something unpardonable, something couldn't be pardoned? Nonsense. But understand, to partake of the Holy Spirit during this age of grace is much more than having the Spirit rest upon a believer, which is what happened to the nation Israel. To partake of the Holy Spirit today is to have the Holy Spirit actually take up residence within the believer. And how many believers does he take up residence in? Every believer. No believer has more of the Holy Spirit than the other believer. It doesn't come in gallonage or tonnage, and you've got, the pastor has 25 pounds per square inch, and you know, and the deacons have 20, and the elders have 22, and you poor people in the pew, we don't know if you have any or not. The janitor may have 5. But you see, that isn't how it works today. We have all the Holy Spirit we're ever going to get inside us. Scripture tells us that when the Holy Spirit takes up residence within us, one of the purposes of that indwelling Holy Spirit is to seal the believer. Now, how long will this seal last, according to Ephesians 4:30? You're reading the passage. It's up there on the overhead. Paul tells us it will last unto the day of the redemption of our earthly tents. So if it's going to last that long, and Paul tells us that, and the Holy Spirit told Paul to tell us that, then can we lose on Thursday what we have the previous Sunday? Absolutely not. There's no unpardonable sin in this age of grace. But the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit was indeed an unpardonable sin to the nation Israel when it came to those who rejected the ministry of all three members of the Godhead. Those folks would have no further opportunity to enter that promised earthly kingdom. Do you remember Stephen's words just before he was stoned by the Christ rejecting Jews of that day? You can read them in Acts chapter 7, beginning with verse 51. We'll put them up for you here. Let's take a quick look at those words. Stephen said, "Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost, just as your fathers did." You're doing the very same thing. "Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted? And they have slain them which showed before the coming of the Just One, of whom ye have been now," watch this, "the betrayers and murderers." You see, Stephen's accusing Israel here, indicting in a very real sense the nation. Stephen said that these folks were the betrayers and the murderers of their Messiah, Jesus Christ. Stephen was referring to the cross there. Do you ever hear any good news there in Stephen's words? Or can you find any good news, I should say it that way, in Stephen's good words? Or words? I don't find any good news sitting there at all. Because the cross was not good news to these Christ-rejecting Jews. It was bad news. It was horrible news. Why, they had crucified their king. And the cross was the evidence that these folks were guilty. It was the worst news I believe these folks could have ever heard. And to make matters even worse, if it were possible, the one they had crucified was now alive. The one who they betrayed, the one who they murdered, was now alive. What kind of news do you suppose it would be to a murderer to hear that the very one he had just slain had come back to life? Would that cause you to quake? I bet you'd lose a few nights' sleep over that. You see, the death, burial, and resurrection was not being heralded as good news. back then. It was a stinging indictment to these Christ-rejecting Jews. It was the same kind of indictment that Peter delivered back at Pentecost. Look at the similarity of Peter's words in Acts chapter 2, verse 36 to those of Stephen. Here's Peter. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus whom ye have crucified, we can underline that part, both Lord and Christ. Wow. No good news sitting there, the ones who slew Christ. You can imagine the thoughts that were spinning around in these folks' heads. The one they had so mercilessly killed was now alive. Cross wasn't good news to these folks, people. Peter didn't say, hey, you guys killed him, but guess what? God meant it for good, and it's all going to turn out good for you folks after all. Simply trust in Christ's death and burial and resurrection on your behalf, and everything will turn out all right. He didn't say that. That wasn't Peter's message. Peter accused these folks, and he told them to repent, to change their thinking, to change their minds, and begin believing that Christ was indeed the promised king of their promised earthly program. And if they would do that, Christ would return to take his rightful place as Israel's king. You see, the good news preached by John, by Peter, by the other apostles, and even being preached by Christ himself during the days of his earthly ministry, concerned Israel's promised earthly kingdom. Does not concern you. You're the folks of a different program. And these folks had rejected that good news. Any folks rejecting the good news that Paul's proclaimed today concerning our program? A lot of folks. So God set that program with that nation aside. He didn't do away with it. He put it on hold for a time. And he ushered in a brand new program with a brand new apostle. That's why there's a 13th. That's why the apostle Paul. That's why Paul said he was a separated apostle back in Romans chapter 1, verse 1. Paul was separate from the other apostles as the apostle of a brand new message, a message that Paul had was specifically separated unto and specifically commissioned to take forth. You see, Paul was not preaching the same message the others had preached. Oftentimes people think that Paul just carried the same message of the 12, the kingdom of God is at hand. He carried that same message on to the Gentiles, but they have a problem. Those promises were physical. They were literal promises of an earthly kingdom. So if we're saying Paul carried that message right on a cross, now we have a dilemma. And to solve that dilemma, what do? They say, well, God never meant any of this literally in the first place. You folks are all mistaken. This is all to be taken in a spiritual sense. It was never a literal physical kingdom. It's really the kingdom of God in our hearts. And you can see where that whole notion came from. But that isn't the case at all. You know, it is literal to them. It will be fulfilled in a day yet future. But God's promised us some things too, and they're different. Paul did indeed teach. Understand this. This is confusing, folks. Paul did indeed teach and tell folks, and he told the Jews that Jesus was indeed their Messiah. But Paul's words were not repent and be baptized, and your king will come back. Paul didn't say that. That was good news while the kingdom program was still in progress, but only while it was in progress. You never hear Paul preaching the good news of Israel's impending earthly kingdom being at hand. So since you never see that, try to find one instance of Paul saying, the kingdom of God is at hand, or the kingdom of heaven is at hand. You'll not find it. So Paul never preached the kingdom gospel, never once. Of course, the fact that Christ had died, had been buried, and had risen from the dead was common truth to both programs. That's not the kingdom gospel. The kingdom gospel is, it's at your doorstep. Your earthly kingdom is at your doorstep. If you repent and be baptized, change your thinking about your Messiah and be baptized, you'll have entrance to that kingdom. Paul never taught that. That good news, that truth would be good news only to those who of Israel who had accepted Christ's messiahship because their king was now living. But the truth of Christ's death, burial, and resurrection would take on a whole new flavor. It would take on a whole new meaning where the apostle of the grace of God was concerned. Paul had been given some brand new news concerning Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. News that God had been keeping secret. He had not revealed it to anyone until the time that the apostle Paul was called out, separated from the others, given a separate message, given these brand new instructions from the risen, ascended Lord of glory. to proclaim to the Gentiles. So we've got a brand new set of good news here to look at. If we were able, if we're ever going to be able to understand the book of Romans, and if we're ever going to be able to be firmly established on the foundation of Jesus Christ according to the way that Paul taught Jesus Christ, we need to understand first and foremost that Paul was given a brand new message. He was not operating under the same commission the 12 had been operating under. Tell me if you see a unified message in these two commissions. First, the commission of the 12, Matthew 28, 19. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. Now, is this not in most doctrinal statements of many fundamental churches in our land today? Certainly it is. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, doing what? Baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Anyone of any nation who wanted to take part in Israel's promised earthly kingdom would have to be baptized. And that was open to Gentiles who would proselyte to Judaism, who would take hold of Israel's covenant. This was true of those folks. And as long as that kingdom was at hand, it was possible for any Gentile, anyone outside of Israel, to become a proselyte to Judaism. Did Paul work under that kingdom commission? Well, the commission so often called the Great Commission, we see Paul didn't operate under that commission. If he did, he would have had to follow the instructions we see there in Matthew 28:19. But notice Paul's words in 1 Corinthians 1:17. For Christ sent me to go into all the nations baptizing them. Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel. What gospel? Well, that gospel Paul would call my gospel, the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery. Not with wisdom of words, Paul says, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. You see, by the time that Saul had his encounter with the ascended Christ on that road to Damascus, that promised earthly kingdom had been placed on hold. It was on the shelf, in a manner of speaking, postponed, pushed forward in time. So what people need to realize today is that God called Paul to be a separate, as he tells us in Romans 1:1, and a distinct or unique apostle, and that there would be something unique and different, something that would set Paul's message apart from any message preached prior to his message. We could say that Paul was uniquely commissioned with a commission different and separate from the 12, and according to this unique commission, Paul was to take forth his unique message to the Gentiles. It was a brand new message of good news, a new message, a new gospel, a gospel called my gospel, as we said. Paul called it the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery. It's still Christ. Don't let anybody try to convince you that if you believe in rightly dividing the word of truth, that you're honoring Paul and elevating Paul above Christ. Where did Paul get his words? Where did Paul get his message for this age of grace? From the ascended Christ, from Christ in glory. So it's still Christ's message, but it's Christ's message concerning a new dispensation, the dispensation of the grace of God. Paul would call his good news the preaching of the cross. So the cross would bear a significant part of this new message Paul would be preaching. According to the good news committed to Paul, the cross would now become not only good news, the cross would become the greatest news we could ever hear, mankind could ever receive. But there was a distinctiveness to Paul's message which needs to be properly understood. Paul's message would have nothing to do with Gentiles taking part in a promised earthly kingdom that where those promises had been made to Israel. Nothing to do with that at all. Paul's good news, we cannot reiterate enough, would be distinct from Christ's earthly rule and reign altogether, and the nation Israel becoming a holy nation and a kingdom of priests. Paul's message would be distinct from the need for any Gentile to become a proselyte to Judaism, and the need for Israel to be placed on back on the shelf, so to speak, so the nations could be then be blessed through the overflow of the blessings that would fall upon that nation. Israel had fallen. Israel had not risen, according to Scripture. Israel had merited no blessings, and Israel's program had been placed on hold, put on the shelf. According to Daniel's prophecy, and we've gone through this here, the 70 weeks of years given in connection with the timing of Israel and their gaining that kingdom, producing that fruit necessary under their law contract to merit those blessings, that time was up. It was up with the stoning of Stephen. Would God give up on Israel's program altogether? Would he do away with his promises to that nation altogether? Well, if you believe that he's done away with that program altogether and that he simply took Israel and wiped them off the face of the earth, spiritually speaking, and put us in their place, you might be called something different this morning. You might be called a covenant believer, because that's precisely what they believe. God would not give up on or renege, go back on the promises he made to that nation. Paul's going to tell us, don't think that way. He simply postponed it. We're going to learn that later on in Romans. God will indeed accomplish his earthly plan, his earthly purpose with his earthly nation, and he's going to do that in a time yet future. But now, during this interim time called the Age of Grace, God is working in a brand new way with mankind, a way to be proclaimed by this new apostle, Paul. God is not working in this dispensation through a special nation. Paul was a separate apostle. Paul tells us himself in Romans chapter 1, verse 1, to the good news God would now commission him to preach. The good news that God would use that very death on the cross of Calvary of Jesus Christ, his burial and his resurrection, to reconcile how many? The entire world unto himself. As the verse says there in 2 Corinthians 5, 18 and 19, not imputing their trespasses, their coming short in rightness unto them. God would make his son, Jesus Christ, he sent him for that purpose, to be sin for the entire human race. Christ, who knew no sin of his own, so that all who would simply believe this good news message might be joined to the person of Christ himself, and through that joining, have Christ's righteousness attributed to their spiritual account. What good news this is for us. During the dispensation of grace, Gentiles would no longer have to come to God through the rise of an earthly nation called Israel. The coming short of rightness issue that had for so long been on the table of God's justice now resolved for how many? All mankind. And the cross of Christ was the means by which that resolution had come. Tell me that's not good news. Tell me that's not something to sing about. Tell me that's not something to make you turn, quote unquote, Pentecostal over. An age of grace was being ushered in, folks, and Paul was to be the head usher, according to the secret that God had been keeping. Who had ever known that Israel was going to fall? She wasn't supposed to fall, not according to prophecy concerning her program. What was she supposed to do? She was supposed to rise, Isaiah said. The Gentiles, in fact, were to come to the brightness of Israel's rising according to prophecy. During the dispensation of grace, this present age of grace, God would form a brand new creation. No longer working through a nation, he would now form a brand new creation called the body of Christ. A new message for a new creation, a message for Jew and Gentile alike with no distinction during this present dispensation. In an age unprophesied, not proclaimed in Scripture. You can't go back to the Old Testament and dig very deep and find it hidden away there. It's untrackable, unsearchable. You can't go back there and work your way forward and say, well, what's sitting back there is just really opened up to us in a brand new way here. It's not the same thing. Different program entirely. So we can see that something new is in progress here with the message given to Paul. A new message, no distinction in national identity here at all, and a message that is given to Paul to deliver to the Gentiles. You know the verses. We've been through these verses, Ephesians 3, 1 and 4. For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ for you Gentiles, and I love the way he says this, if you've even heard of the dispensation of the grace of God which is given me to you. How many folks have heard about it today? I don't think very many folks have heard about it. How that by revelation, revelations from Christ himself, the ascended Christ, he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote in a few words, not something mysterious, not something for some reality TV show to get your spine tingling. Mysterion simply means secret. God had been keeping a secret, and now he's revealing it to Paul. Whereby when ye read, ye may understand my knowledge in this secret concerning Christ. Whereof I am made a minister, Paul writes in Colossians chapter 1, verses 25 through 27, according to the dispensation of God which is given to me for you. That's why we have this dispensation on your dispensational chart called the dispensation of grace. To fulfill the word of God, to complete the word of God. Even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations except for the 12, and of course John taught it and Christ taught a little bit about it here and there. What does he say? hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles. Here we are, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Wow, something entirely different from Israel's promised earthly kingdom, and they're becoming a holy nation and a royal priesthood. This is different, folks. Different message entirely. Romans 16:25, Paul says, now to him that is of power to stabilize you according to my gospel. You see the distinctiveness of the good news message and the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the secret that God had been keeping, which was kept secret since the world began. So you won't find anybody teaching this till you come to Paul. Romans 11:13, for I speak to you Gentiles inasmuch as I am the apostle of the Gentiles. I magnify my office. Paul never magnified himself, only magnified the special, unique position God gave him as the apostle of this age of grace. Why Paul could say, 1 Timothy 1:16, howbeit for this cause I obtain mercy, that in me, along with the 12, along with John, along with the prophets before them, that in me, and what's the next word? First, Jesus Christ might show forth all long-suffering for a pattern to them which should hereafter believe on him to life everlasting. Now, let's take this a step further in this study. Let's suppose that God had not separated out a brand new apostle with a brand new message for a brand new creation called the body of Christ. Let's suppose that did not take place. Instead, let's imagine for a moment that just before Stephen was stoned, when Stephen saw Christ standing at the right hand of God the Father, that instead of discontinuing that kingdom program, putting it on the shelf, ushering in something new, imagine with me for a moment that God had allowed that kingdom program to continue on as some believe today. Let's say for another 30, 40 years, as our Acts 28 friends would tell us, and as some would say, even beyond that, even to this present day. What message would we as Gentiles have heard under those circumstances? Had that program continued on, what would have been the message that Paul's delivering? Would what we would hear in that situation be the same message Paul delivers to us in Romans? I think not. Would it have been the message of the superabounding grace of God where Gentiles are concerned? No. You see, according to Israel's program, when Christ was cut off, according to Daniel, 483 years of Daniel's prophecy fulfilled, the time for that nation to come to their last days prior to the entrance of their kingdom had come close to hand. Only 7 years remained at that period of time, folks, on Israel's prophecy clock before the earthly kingdom would be set up and Christ would be ruling and reigning on the throne. So if God had not supernaturally set Israel aside to usher in this new dispensation, just consider it for a moment, let me show you the message you would be hearing now instead of the message of Romans. Go back with me to the time of Pentecost in your minds. I'll set the stage. Israel had come to her final days, to the point in time just prior to the 7 remaining years preceding their promised earthly kingdom. You see why it's called her final days. She's right on the horizon of that kingdom, but she's got to go through 7 years of time of Jacob's trouble first. That's why the kingdom was being proclaimed as being at hand. The gift of tongues is being manifested, and every man is hearing those gifted speak in his own language at Pentecost. That's what God had promised in connection with that earthly kingdom. Some are doubting, some are listening, and some are doubting. Some are saying those speaking in tongues are drunk. Peter corrects these folks in Acts 2, verses 15 through 17. Listen to Peter. For these are not drunken, as you suppose, seeing is but the third hour of the day. But this is that's happening right now at Pentecost that you folks are witnessing. This is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. It shall come to pass, Joel wrote, in the last days, saith God, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Notice the pronouns. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. To whom is Peter speaking here with all these your pronouns? Well, he's talking to the Jews and he's talking to proselytes to Judaism, according to Acts chapter 2:10. He's talking to devout Jews from every nation, according to Acts 2:5. He says, to ye men of Judea, in Acts 2:14. Your sons, your old men shall dream dreams. Whose sons and daughters, and whose old men? Ye men of Israel, according to Acts 2:22. You see it, folks? How many are claiming to be Jews today? And claiming this is them, and all these things have been poured out upon them. But get two of them together and tell them to agree on anything they want, and let's see if it happens. Peter was quoting the prophet Joel, all in connection with God's earthly nation Israel, and their being on the threshold of that kingdom, tribulation first. Now stay with me as we look at Joel's words. Joel 2:28, it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons, your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids, in those days will I pour out of my spirit. This is precisely what was taking place at Pentecost, according to Peter. Israel had entered the final stage before her earthly kingdom. The final days prior to that kingdom, 7 years on the calendar left before Christ's earthly return. 483 years of Daniel's prophecy already transpired. Joel goes on in the first part of verse 30 to describe the impending tribulation and the events that would soon take place leading up to the final part of this terrible tribulation period, beginning with verse 30. Listen to Joel, and I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire, pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord come. The tribulation was on its way when Pentecost took place. It was the next thing on Israel's prophetic calendar. The beginning of Israel's final time period prior to her setting up of her kingdom. Peter quoted the apostle Joel, or the prophet Joel, at Pentecost and said, this is that. In other words, these are the last days, Israel. You're right here. Your kingdom's at hand. These are the last days Joel was talking about. Now follow me here. Peter's not saying this is the birthday of something new. Peter's saying this is that prophesied by Joel. These are the last days for Israel's program. If the last days Joel was speaking about refer to the birthday of the church, if God did not supernaturally put his earthly program on hold to usher in, as we said, a brand new dispensation through a brand new apostle with a brand new message, what message would we as Gentiles be hearing instead of the message of Romans? Joel tells us what we would be hearing. Look with me at the very next chapter in Joel, Joel chapter 3. For behold, in those days, Joel writes, and in that time, in what days, and in what time, in the days Peter's referring to as being Israel's final days, the days that were upon Israel when Pentecost, the day of Pentecost had occurred, when I shall bring again the captivity of Judah and Jerusalem. Now, what was supposed to happen in those days? They're going to return to their lands. He's going to return them to the land supernaturally. Continue reading, verse 2. I will also gather all nations. Stop for a moment. I'm going to gather all nations. What does the word nations mean? It's goi in Hebrew. It's Gentiles. I'm going to gather together all the Gentiles. And I'm going to bring them, the Gentiles of the time spoken here, folks, down into the valley of Jehoshaphat, and will plead with them there for my people, Israel, and for my heritage, Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and parted my land. Folks, if God had not put Israel's program on the shelf, on hold, pushed it further ahead in time, if he had not ushered in a brand new program with a brand new apostle for a brand new creation, what would be the words we would be hearing right now? God would be gathering Gentiles, and he'd be bringing them down into a valley called Jehoshaphat. And lest you think this is good news for the Gentiles, let me ask you something. We talked about this many years ago, but I'm going to remind you of it here. Many of you weren't here then. How many of you were ever challenged to a fight in your life? Any of you? I was in my younger days in high school. I would say junior high school. Transferred to a new school. Had some friends around me, made new friends. But one fella came up, and I think he was a little jealous of the new friends I had made. So he put his finger in my face, and he said, I challenge you to fight I'm going to fight you. And he's quite a bit bigger than me. And I can tell you then, I was no braver then than I am now. I'd rather make a deal. But he said, you want to fight? Come on, let's fight. I'll never forget it. Before I had a chance to even open my mouth, one of the guys that was there with me said, he's not afraid of you. Oh, please. You know, please. He's not afraid of you. He'll fight you anytime. And immediately this monster hit me in the stomach, hard as he could hit me. You know, when the adrenaline's pumping, you don't feel it like I think you'd feel it if the adrenaline wasn't pumping, but I felt it. And to save face in front of those other kids that were with me, you know what I said? Come on, I'll fight you. No, I didn't. I said, only after school, not on the school grounds. That would get me out of this thing right there. Well, he said, I'm going to meet you after school. I'm going to be here, and it'll be the last fight that you'll ever be in. I never did meet him. The bell rang. And when that bell rang, from that point on, I never saw that bully again. Needless to say, I didn't look for that bully again. Now, I told you that because if God had not rung the bell on Israel's program in order to usher in a brand new program through a brand new apostle, that calls this the dispensation of the grace of God, listen to the message we Gentiles would have heard instead of the message of this Romans epistle. We find it in Joel chapter 3, beginning with verse 9. Proclaim ye this among who here? Among the Gentiles. Do what, you Gentiles? Prepare war. In other words, you'd better get ready, you Gentiles. Wake up the mighty men of the Gentiles. Let all the men of war draw near. Let them come up. God just said he was going to gather the Gentiles. We just read it. Beat your plowshares into swords, you Gentiles, and your pruning hooks into spears, you Gentiles. Let the weak among you say, I'm strong. Assemble yourselves. Come, all ye heathen. Same Greek Greek word, goi there, Hebrew word, Gentiles. Gather yourselves together round about. Thither cause thy mighty ones to come. Bring your strongest. In fact, bring your best and meet me here in this valley. The Gentiles are being told to prepare war. Why? Who would be going to fight here? Read on with me, verse 12. Let the heathen, goi, Gentiles again, be wakened. Come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat, for there will I, God, sit to judge all the Gentiles round about. Put ye in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. Come, get you down, for the press is full, the vats overflow, for their wickedness is great. You see, God's not the bully here, folks, believe it or not. Don't think that for a moment, but I guarantee you that this is the final fight these Gentiles will ever take part in. Listen to this as Joel continues in verse 14. Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision, for the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. What decision is he talking about here, folks? The decision the Gentiles will have to make in this day yet future concerning that nation Israel when God puts them back in the place of the head of the nations. You see, at the culmination of the tribulation period, they're going to be coming, the nations are going to be coming against Israel itself. And the Gentiles will be the bullies when this day arrives. The sun and the moon shall be darkened, the stars shall withdraw their shining. The Lord also shall roar out of Zion and utter his voice from Jerusalem, and the heavens and the earth shall shake. Can you imagine it? The heavens and the earth shall shake. But the Lord will be the hope of, who does it say here? His people. And the strength of, who does it say here? The children of Israel. He's going to fight the Gentiles on behalf of his nation. Do you see why Peter, James, and John were offering deliverance to the remnant of Israel on the day of Pentecost? God's coming to stand up for the remnant. And who will Christ be coming to fight? The Gentiles. That's the message we would have been hearing, folks, had that program been allowed to continue on and God not set it on the shelf, ushering in a brand new age through a brand new apostle, for a brand new message for a brand new creation. That's the message we'd have been hearing if God had not rung the bell, in a manner of speaking, on the kingdom program to usher in a dispensation of grace. We can be so thankful today, wouldn't you say? We can be so thankful today that God did not allow his program with Israel to come to fulfillment. Not yet. Because if he had, we Gentiles would have been told, prepare for war, just as the Gentiles of time future will be told to do. And we know that the only hope for the Gentiles when this day takes place will be for those people who are willing at that time to take their rightful place under Israel, recognizing that Israel is again in the spotlight as God begins to take up once again where he left off with his chosen people, the children of Israel. The only hope for the Gentiles of that time will be for those who bless Israel rather than curse Israel. Thank God he caused a halt to that program. That program's been placed on the shelf. When Stephen saw Christ standing at the right hand of the Father, ready to come and wage war with the nations, the Gentiles, something that no one had ever foreseen took place. God temporarily suspended. He temporarily placed that program on the shelf, as we said, as we're going to be learning later on in this Romans epistle. Beginning with chapter 9, we're going to begin to learn some of these things as Paul gets to the dispensational part of this epistle. God put that program on hold because he had a secret program in mind, a program that would require a brand new apostle, a program that God had in mind before the foundation of this earth. I want to review that passage one more time in Ephesians. Here it is once again. For this cause, I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles, if you have heard of this dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me to you word, how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote it in few words, whereby when ye read ye may understand my knowledge in this secret concerning Christ, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now being revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. Now, in case you think I've belabored this, the distinctiveness of Paul's unique Gentile apostleship, this is fundamental. This is fundamental to our understanding the message of Romans as being a brand new message, one that had not been previously revealed, a different message from the 12 before Paul. And I want us to have that firmly settled in our minds before we continue on. If we want to be stabilized today, established today, we can't go back and read ourselves into that program, to any portion of that program, because we're not sitting there. We need to come to realize that God has given us a portion of his word specifically written about us. And it's the epistles, Romans through Philemon. It was the epistles written by this new apostle, the Apostle Paul. All of the Bible for our learning. All of the Bible for our understanding. But a portion of that Bible written specifically about us today. If we want to be established, we need to be careful not to mix the good news Paul reveals in Romans with the good news the others have been preaching concerning Israel's promised earthly kingdom. Mixing these two programs will lead to nothing but confusion and the very opposite of being stabilized. Look once more at Paul's words. Now to him that is of power to stabilize you, to establish you according to my gospel, and the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest. When we take the gospel message Paul's now ready to deliver to establish these Romans, and when we hold this and Paul's other epistles up alongside the scriptures of the prophets concerning Israel's program and all that will take place in time future, and we know how to rightly divide between those two programs, that's when we'll know where we fit in, and that's where we'll become stabilized in what scripture has to say about us. All the marvelous benefits that have accrued to your account the very instant you took God is his word concerning what Christ did at Calvary where your sin debt is concerned. We might notice something else here. Paul said that he was writing these things to Roman believers. We know that. They were believers. Paul called them saints. He's writing to people who are already believers here. Paul called them saints back in chapter 1, verse 7. They'd already trusted in Christ as Savior through his finished crosswork on their behalf, but Paul's about to reveal to them some things about their salvation in this book, which will help stabilize these folks, make them firm in what they believe. That's the purpose of the book of Romans. Paul's about to take the faith doctrines called justification, sanctification, dispensation, And he's going to open those doctrines up in a fuller manner to those who are the recipients of that brand new message. And Romans, the Romans being Gentiles primarily, were who responded positively to Paul's message, were recipients of all the benefits of justification and sanctification, and Paul's going to explain that to them. They didn't need to become saved. Understand that. They needed to become established in their faith. Any of us there? I think we're all still there. We all can use these things. These are basic truths, and we all need to have them reaffirmed from time to time. These folks needed to become fully aware of all the wonderful things that belong to them in Christ. That's the reason Paul said, here it is, back in Romans 1:15, where we left off in our previous section of Romans, so as much as is in me is, as much as in me is, with everything I've got, that's the present time vernacular, with everything that I've got, folks, I'm ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. Paul's ready to preach good news concerning the cross to these Romans. He's ready to expound on his new message concerning the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now remember, when the other apostles preached the cross, their message to Israel was meant to bring shame upon their audience. And it did bring shame upon some of those folks. What does Paul say? Let's see. Romans chapter 1, verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the good news of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. As is written, the just shall live by faith.
Thank you for joining with us in your endeavor to discover the truths in God's Word. Pastor and teacher Kirk Christ and the entire fellowship of Welcome to Grace Ministries would like to thank you for your support of this ministry of grace. If you're enjoying the teachings and want to share with others, please write us at Welcome to Grace Ministries, P.O. Box 90, Penrose, North Carolina, 28766. You may call us toll-free at 877-770-7098 or visit us on the web at www.welcometograce.com. Again, thank you for joining us, and we look forward to